Good evening. Could I get everybody's attention, please? My name is Russ Ramsey, and on behalf of the entire Board of Trustees, I just want to welcome everyone to what truly is one of the most exciting times that I can imagine for George Washington University. And, you know, when you sit here and think about the magnitude of this groundbreaking and what it means for not just today, but for the future of our university, I just think everyone needs to kind of take a pause and just reflect on, you know, how far we have come. It only seems like yesterday that we had a very similar gathering for what at the time we called Square 54, which is this magnificent complex that we see out to my right, which is now just simply called the Avenue. And I think we probably have all seen, in a small way, what the value of a really iconic presence can do to really change, in this case, you know, a neighborhood and a sort of an apparatus, and it's just really brought a source of pride to everyone associated with it. And so, just to prior to asking the president to come up and share in some of the details around this glorious day, I just want to say that I think, as many people here know, this university has its 200th anniversary coming up in really less than 10 short years. And going back to the, you know, early days of President Knapp's tenure here, you know, as we thought about, you know, sort of the vision for this university and really aspiring to really be thought of in the ranks of the great universities, I think you've all heard me say that, you know, the whole idea of vision, you know, without execution is hallucination. And I think that's always important to think about, because you have a great vision, but you have to execute. And so I think what we're seeing here today is not the beginnings of execution. I mean, this is really, you know, this is the culmination of lots and lots, and not just months, but years, and in some cases decades, of planning and thinking and really talented, committed people thinking about the value of science and engineering, and how the future of this university, and I would say the future of this country, relies on having greatness associated with real breakthroughs in science, real breakthroughs in engineering. And so I just want to thank everyone for what you've done to get us to this point. And I'd like to welcome President Knapp to the stage to kind of tell us about how we go forward. So thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Russ. Well, you know, there are so many people who've been involved in this, and I think what the chairman just said about the process that's led us to this point, it's almost hard to overestimate the amount of thought and effort and planning that has gone into this project over years that preceded my arrival here. And I do want to thank some categories. I'm going to thank some individuals, but I also want to mention some categories of people. And let me start where you really ought to start, and that is with our faculty, because it was the Faculty Senate. We have some faculty senators who are right here. Faculty, just raise your hands so we can see some of the faculty that are here. We've got them all throughout the audience here. We have, I see Professor Garris, who's a faculty Senate member, Professor Hulgert's on the Faculty Senate. It was the Faculty Senate that in 2004, so 3 years before my arrival, actually passed a resolution stating that the highest priority in terms of academic facilities for the university was the construction of a new home for our science and engineering departments. Because I think the faculty at that time realized, and they had terrific support from the Board of Trustees in this, I'll talk about that in a moment, realized that to be the truly world-class university that we are every day becoming, we have to have facilities that are the equal of our world-class faculty. And that's exactly what we're bringing about with this project. I want to mention one member of the faculty in particular who I think really kept this flame burning, and now emeritus. He's the George Gamow Professor of Theoretical Physics Emeritus, and also the Executive Vice President for Academic Affairs. Don Lehman is here today. Where is Don? There he is. Don, stand up. Stand up, Don. And I, you know, one of the reasons we're able to do this is because of the extraordinarily careful planning that the Board of Trustees engaged in before my arrival. It involved things like figuring out how to take this piece of property that the chairman pointed to, which is now the Avenue, and make that a resource for the future of the university. And of course, as I think everyone knows, part of our financial plan is that the revenue that that project generates is going to help us as one component of a carefully constructed plan to pay for this structure, which will be paid for. It's not going to be a burden on the university. It's going to be an enhancement to everything we do. And I have to give credit to the Board of Trustees, trustee leadership for having the vision, and this very much our chairman, Russ Rams. I want to personally acknowledge him because that avenue is very much his personal vision, and it's an extraordinary contribution to this neighborhood here. And on the Board of Trustees, our Vice Chair, Nelson Carbonell, led the process through the board of thinking through the nature of this project and how we're going to support it and how we're going to accomplish it. And so let me also mention Nelson Carbonell right over here. And much as I hate to do it, I have to single out one other individual in my administration who seems to get all these crazy projects accomplished somehow. None of us understand quite how it happens, but I do have to mention Lou Katz. Now, we do have a very important partner in this project who happens to be with us today, and I think he will tell you, and we're very moved when this happened, but was so inspired by the fact that we were taking this step that he created a scholars program that in the School of Engineering. And some of those students, we already have the first cohort of the Clark scholars who have joined our School of Engineering. It's really, I think, a very inspiring program. But I have to tell you, Jim Clark, you're over here somewhere. Jim, would you wave? Thank you. Head of Clark Construction. I think Mr. Clark actually owes us a little bit for some lost productivity that we had this semester because probably an inappropriate number of our faculty, staff, and even some of our students spent a long time watching that dinosaur-like creature tear down the parking garage that was out here. It was really so, you can even watch it on online, as a matter of fact, which some people were able to do at their computer stations, but to see that. If you didn't see it, I'm sorry that you missed it. Maybe we can find it on, you'll be able to find it on YouTube or something. But this Tyrannosaurus Rex-like creature that was ripping out huge chunks of the parking garage tore it down in record time, and it's now gone. We decided it would be a little less hazardous to do our groundbreaking up here than to actually climb down into the hole that was left in its wake. But I do want to acknowledge Jim Clark, an extraordinary company, a terrific company that's building. I think, as Jim, you once told me, you always make a point of doing at least 25 construction projects in the nation's capital at any given time, and I know that's happening right now. So let me recognize Jim Clark over here. Two more categories I want to mention. You know, there's always been a lot of publicity about our relationship with our neighbors because, like every university, you know, we are coexisting in a residential neighborhood here that's a very important part of our community. And I have to say that our neighbors, some of whom are here today, played an instrumental role in bringing about the zoning victories that were needed to be able to accomplish a project like this. So can the neighbors, if they're here, can you be recognized, please? And just, I know some of them here, if they can wave. Neighbors, come on, hands up. Thank you. And I will mention one last category. You know, a number of you heard me tell the story about when I went to the first block party, in the fall of 2007, we always have this block party. We just had it last Sunday. It's between the hospital and the medical school. And the first time I went, there was a table there of students wearing sort of very sharp little T-shirts that had an insignia on the shoulder. And I found out for the first time that we had an organization here called Campaign GW. These are students, and well, I hate to mention again, they were kind of organized by Mr. Katz, and they went to zoning hearings that made it possible for us to accomplish our 20-year campus plan that included this academic space here and the development that makes it possible right across the street. So I just want to recognize that we would not be where we are if we didn't have the energetic and passionate support of our students. Not only science and engineering majors, but even students from other fields, from the humanities, the social science, our policy fields, they realize how important this project is to the future of this university, and they have supported it from day one, and their eloquence and passion have helped to make this possible. So if we've got students here, I want to recognize them as well. And in closing, let me just say a few things about this building. The first thing I think to say is that Washington, D.C. is often thought of as a center of power in politics, and it certainly is that. But we also have probably more physicists within a 20-mile radius of where we're standing right now than any other part of the country. And that's because we have the NIST, the National Institute of Standards and Technology. We have the National Science Foundation. We have, you know, parts of NASA. We have, you know, if you just look around this community that we're part of here, we're in the core of an extraordinary concentration of the arts, of intellect, and of the sciences, and of engineering, and of technology. And that's one reason why it makes sense to put a facility like this in the heart of this nation's capital, which is also the heart of a vital region of science and technology. But it's important for another reason, and that is to be a powerful institution devoted to making advances in the realm of policy. In today's world, you have to have credibility and power and competence and excellence in science and engineering. To be a comprehensive university, to be a world-class university, you have to have that. But you also have to have that to undergird the strength that we have developed in policy, in the humanities, in the arts. And so I think this project is absolutely integral to everything that we are trying to achieve as a university. I'll say just a couple things about the building itself. It will be a collaborative space. It's designed that way. If you get a chance to look at any of the drawings, you'll see how carefully it's been put together to reflect the changes that are occurring in science, the emphasis on team, on cross-disciplinary work, the emphasis on breaking new ground when there are new research opportunities that come up, so the top two floors will be shelled out so that they can be the home of new exciting projects that are going to bring together faculty from a range of departments, from the sciences, from engineering, from our medical institutions, public health, medicine, our School of Nursing, our medical faculty associates, whoever can bring those kinds of rich projects to light here at the university will have an opportunity to work with colleagues in this building, which will also house all of our science and engineering departments in the Columbian College of Arts and Sciences. And I want to recognize Dean Barrett, who's been a real leader in this effort right here. And in the school, and in the School of Engineering and Applied Science. And Dean Dolling is here as well, so David. And Mr. Clark was remarking, who was a trustee emeritus, was remarking earlier that this will be the largest academic building on our campus. That is certainly true, and I can guarantee you it will be the largest science and engineering building within six blocks of the White House. Thank you very much. And it's my pleasure to introduce another president, John Richardson, president of the Student Association.
There's no pocket there. So I don't normally speak on behalf of all the students here at George Washington University. It's generally a bad idea. But today I think it's appropriate to convey our excitement and high expectations for this new science and engineering hall and what it will mean to this community. GW prides itself on training the citizen leaders of tomorrow, not just for the betterment of the city and country, but also for our global community. Oftentimes, we get wrapped around the term citizen leader in reference to politics, community service, and foreign affairs. However, today, the George Washington University reaffirms its commitment that being a good citizen leader means more than just being involved in the political realm, but being a leader in no matter what we are called to do. For the students and faculty who will call this place their home, it is our great hope that they will continue to be citizen leaders in thought, innovation, and ethics as it relates not only to the fields of science and engineering, but also to the fields in which they are connected. This new world-class facility will match the top-caliber students and faculty that we have here, as well as facilitate their growth as citizen leaders, not only for this community in our city, but for this country and our global community as a whole. It's my great pleasure to introduce Trustee Carbonell, 1985 graduate of CS. He joined the George Washington University Board of Trustees in 2001 and currently chairs the Special Committee on the Science and Engineering Hall and has made great strides to make this project a reality. So, Trustee Carbonell.
Thank you, John, President Knapp, Chairman Ramsey. This is really a great day. As John mentioned, I'm the Vice Chairman of the George Washington University Board of Trustees. I'm also a 1985 grad from the engineering school with a degree in electrical engineering. I want to tell you a little bit about what this means to me, because it means that to so many that came before me and that came after me. Many of you think of GW as a great place to study the law or international relations or philosophy, political science. But many of you may not know that GW has been at the forefront of science for a long time. If you heard, Don Lehman is the George Gamow Professor of Physics. And George Gamow, if you don't know who he was really a spectacular scientist. And he was here at GW. Now, if you want to know what George Gamow did, you'll have to take Don's classes, which I did when I was an undergraduate here. But there have been other great scientists that followed. Don Lehman came to school here. People like Mark Hughes came to school here. And we have educated generations of engineers. But there's something about the way that we educated them that needs to change, and that has needed to change for a long time. When we were talking to the board about building a new facility, meeting in 1957 E Street, which doesn't look like we need any new facilities if you ever go there, there just didn't seem to be the connection with, why do we need this? So we took the board on a tour, and we toured Corcoran Hall, and we toured Tompkins Hall, and we went to the basement of Tompkins Hall. And the one thing that connects generations of GW engineers and scientists is we studied in really crummy facilities. And it made us scrappy, right? I mean, there, you know, we walked into Corcoran Hall and there was a guy who had like some huge machine balanced on some floorboards in the middle of the room, hoping it didn't crash through to the floor beneath. True. So what we need to do is keep that scrappy feeling, keep that GW engineers and scientists can do a lot with a little. But just imagine what we can do with a lot. Just imagine what we can do with this facility. Who knows what will be discovered here? A cure for cancer. A new source of energy. The sky's the limit, because when you combine what GW engineers and scientists can do with world-class facilities in a location that has resources like no other place on Earth, you have an unbeatable combination. So what's more than just the building here is really something that's significant in our history, and that is to live up to the promise of who we can be. And GW has had, as the room will attest, many, many successful scientists and engineers and lawyers and accountants and philosophers and other professions. But today we're here to build this in the District of Columbia, and it will be the place where new heights in science and engineering are reached. And I think that deserves a round of applause. So we have many honored guests that I would like to call up the first group. And so many people contributed so much to this, it's hard to really name them all. So we're gonna try our best to give them a little piece of the action here at building this next facility. So I'd like to call up our first group, Chairman Ramsey, President Knapp, Provost Steve Lehrman, Scott Amy, Trustee Scott Amy, Trustee David Carlgaard, Trustee Mark Hughes, the aforementioned Lou Katz, Dean Peg Barrett, and Dean Dolling. And I just want to say, these two deans worked unbelievably hard to provide for their faculty and their students this facility. And I want to thank them really from the bottom of my heart, because they did an enormous amount of work. Trustee Ellen Zane, Charles Barber from the General Counsel's Office, Don Lehman. Come up, Don. John Richardson, if you could come up. And Mr. Clark, if you could come up as well.
We would now like to bring up the following members of the GW Board of Trustees. Trustees Scott Amy, Sissy Barker, Sissy Baker, Richard Blackburn, Maria Bonetti, Trustee Emeritus Luther Brady, Vice Chairman Nelson Carbonell, Trustee Emeritus James Clark, Trustees Lee Fensterstock, Heather Foley, Secretary of the Board Alan Frum, Trustee Emeritus Gary Granoff, Trustees Diana Enriquez, Mark Hughes, James Humphreys, David Carlgaard, Stuart Kassan, and GW President Steven Knapp. We would now like to bring up the following members of the GW Board of Trustees: President Steven Knapp, Trustee Rick Knapp, Trustee Emeritus Eugene Lampert, Trustees Gerald Lazarus, Randy Levine, David Nadler, BJ Penn, Robert Perry, Chairman of the GW Board of Trustees, Russell Ramsey, Trustees Deborah Ratner Salzberg, Mark Shankman, Robert Tenenbaum, Cynthia Vance, George Weldy, Omar Woodward, Ellen Zane.
So I'd like to introduce the next group, and at GW we do this fascinating thing, which works really well, and that is we put together committees that have like 40 people on them, and the committees are drawn from all kinds of different people. Trustees come, donors come, faculty, deans, people from the administration. And I would say, Don, is it 7 years ago? 7 years ago, this committee met for the first time. And our charge was to put together the plan, figure out how we're going to pay for, and really get the community behind this new Science and Engineering Hall. So I would like to bring up the members of that committee who really did yeoman's work to get make this a reality. Interim Dean Ackman, Trustee Scott Amy, Dean Peg Barrett, Vice President Leo Chalupa, Vince Cipinelli, Dean Dolling, Herman Helgert, Trustee Mark Hughes, Trustee Dave Carlgaard, Lou Katz, President Steven Knapp, John Corman, Trustee Jerry Lazarus, Provost Lehrman, Mike Morseberger, Randy Packer, Nick Palaiologos, Barbara Porter, Dave Ramaker, Lorraine Bowles, Linda Whirling, and Ellen Zane. If all of you could please come up and we'll squeeze in. Okay, so I'd like to bring up the next group. There are many people in the GW administration that have had a hand in making this happen. I'd like to bring up some of the members of that group, Alan Wasserman, Aristide Collins, Barbara Porter, Beth Nolan, Doug Guthrie, Gene Johnson, Dean Jeff Ackman, Leo Chalupa, Lorraine Bowles, Lynn Goldman, Michael Fuhrer, and Mike Morseberger.
Please welcome to the stage Dean of the Columbian College of Arts and Sciences, Peg Barrett.
Thank you very much. In Columbian College of Arts and Sciences, we do great science, but this building will be transformative. We are very excited to be at this stage. I'd like to welcome for the next row here, beginning with Pamela Lawrence, who's the chair of my National Council for Arts and Sciences. Other members of that National Council, Mark Albert, Madeline Jacobs, Beth Loker, Melissa Maxman, Alan Nadell, Bill Warren, Alan Zane. And then from the Dean's Office, Associate Dean Randall Packer, chair of my Department of Chemistry and professor of chemistry, Michael King, Diana Lipscomb, Chair of the Department of Biology, Alina Opper, Chair of the Department of Physics, David Raymaker, Professor of Chemistry, and Brian Richmond, Chair of the Department of Anthropology and Head of our Hominid Paleobiology Program, Columbian College of Arts and Sciences.
And now welcome to the stage, Dean of the School of Engineering and Applied Sciences, David Dahling.
Good afternoon, everybody. I'm David Dahling, Dean of the School of Engineering and Applied Sciences, and I have to say I am close to speechless this afternoon, but not exactly speechless. This is a wonderful day. That's all I can say. It's a terrific day. I'd like to invite up the group that comprised the C's shovel list. I kind of like that phrase. These are people from the school, from the alumni group, from others who really be integral in planning the design of the building, the construction of the building, and donors who are helping make this building possible. Trustee Scott Amy, Trustee Nelson Carbonell, Aaron Hegarty, alumnus, Professor Herman Helgert, Trustee Mark Hughes and Susan Hughes, Trustee David Calgard, Sasan Kimiavi, C's alumnus, Professor John Corman, Nick Paleologos, NAC member and alumnus, Michael Plesniak, Chair of Mechanical and Aerospace Engineering, Kim Roddis, Chair of Civil and Environmental Engineering, Andre Rogers, alumnus, Julie Ryan, Chair of the Department of Engineering Management and Systems Engineering, Howard Tischler, Chair of our National Advisory Council, Robert Truland, Abdu Youssef, Chair of the Department of Computer Science, and Mona Zagul, Chair of the Department of Electrical and Computer Engineering. So C's group, show them how shovels are used.
We would now like to welcome to the stage John Rawls, Special Advisor for Communication and Outreach in the Division of Operations. We'll bring up Campaign GW Group.
Hi, everyone. I'm bringing up students, including those in Campaign GW and some alumni and friends. One of them brought me on the way in a copy of a letter he wrote 5 years ago, almost to the day, in support of this project. So they've been working at this for a long time. April McIntyre, please come up. Maddie Boots, Malcolm Fui, Argent Awasti, Richard Livingston, Dylan F. Pine, Katie Lewis, Eric Ishida, Wynn Sheffield, Will Roan, Greg Lederbach, Adil Khan, Kristen Pallister, SA President John Richardson, join us again. Rosanna Gerlandino, Jason Lipton, former president, and then some wonderful alums, Jim Kaur and Laura Taducci Downs. Please join us up here and show them how students shovel. Hang on. Get in here. Lessons. Oh, sure.
We would now like to welcome to the stage Executive Vice President and Treasurer Lou Katz.
Had to get down on my knees to get the list. What I want to welcome now is the project team. This is the team of individuals who planned, zoned, designed, and ultimately will build this project, a very important part of it. Obviously, first from GW, Alicia Knight, Charles Barber, Amy Arganinsky, Susie Cora, Nancy Giamatteo, Jim Schroat, Doug Spangle, Harold Speed, Alex Weller, Megan Chapel Brown, from Boston Properties, Peter Johnston, John Curtis, Damona Smith Stronmanskis, Steve Morkin from Ballinger, Craig Spangler, Bill Gustafson, Steve Whittier, and then Clark Construction, James Clark, Brian Apt, Mike Alto, Robbie Moser, Tyler Dockendorf, Bruce Whedon, Mike Wolski, Dave Tachetti, and then finally legal counsel Maureen Dwyer and Dave Avitable.
Done this afternoon.
Oh, man.
All this work.
Thank you. I was going to keep this.
Thank you, man.
Where's Bruce? Bruce left. Hitting? I'm
up there. How do you just fall off the back?
Yeah, really.
So, if we forgot you, I am really sorry. And I promise you we'll get a picture of you with a shovel. Just please come see us. But we only had time for 100 people. So, thanks all of you for coming. I hope you enjoyed the special event. We would like to invite everyone back in January of 2015, when we open the Science and Engineering Hall. So you're all invited to come back. Please enjoy the reception, and we'll see you in 2015. Thank you very much.